the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you emptied yourself and took on the form of a slave. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you became obedient to the point of death on a cross. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are exalted to the glory of God. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Manifest your almighty power, above all by pardoning and showing mercy. Bestow, we pray, your grace abundantly upon us, and make those hastening to attain your promises heirs to the treasures of heaven. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord, you say, the Lord's way is not fair. Hear now, house of Israel. Is it my way that is unfair, or rather, or not, are not your ways unfair? When someone virtuous turns away from virtue to commit iniquity and dies, it is because of the iniquity he committed that he must die. But if he turns from the wickedness he has committed and does what is right and just, he shall preserve his life. Since he has turned away from all the sins that he has committed, he shall surely live. He shall not die. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any solace in love, any participation in the Spirit, any compassion and mercy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, with the same love, united in heart, thinking one thing. Do nothing out of selfishness or out of vainglory. Rather, humbly regard others as more important than yourselves, each looking out not for his own interests, but also for those of others. Have in you the same attitude that is also in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness. And found human in appearance, he humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, of those in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
And elders of the people, what is your opinion? A man had two sons. He came to the first and said, "Son, go out and work in the vineyard today." He said in reply, "I will not," but afterwards changed his mind and went. The man came to the other son and gave the same order. He said in reply, "Yes, sir," but did not go. Which of the two did his father's will? They answered, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Amen, I say to you, tax collectors and prostitutes are entering the kingdom of God before you. When John came to you in the way of righteousness, you did not believe him, but tax collectors and prostitutes did. Yet even when you saw that, you did not later change your minds and believe him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It's good to be with you again. I've been making my rounds, so I got a few parishes left and missions to visit this. And then after about another month, I've visited all of our 57 parishes and 38 missions three times. So in 3.5 years. So I'll keep doing it until I fall over dead. And hopefully that happens sooner rather than later so I can go to heaven. But I'll stay alive as long as my dear Lord needs us to, huh? As we stay together. But it's been delightful to go around, and it's, I just got back from Rome, had my baby bishop's school, 3.5 years late. I could have taught the dang thing. Almost everything that they covered, I had already done. But it was delightful to be with 115 bishops from around the world that were just all named bishops in the last 6 months, so a few of us. It's quite amazing to spend that 7 days together. Who knows, maybe I was hanging out with a future pope. So it was really exciting. At the end of it, we had 2.5 hours with our Holy Father and a private audience with him. And he came in and he said, I have no text, I have no agenda. Ask anything you want and be bold. And we had a wonderful discussion back and forth. And we asked him some tough questions. But it was a great encouragement. I came back very encouraged and rejuvenated and very supported by the Holy Father. So it was touching. He said to us, "You're my brothers. It's not so easy to be a bishop these days or a pope, but we have Jesus. We have Jesus who chose us, and so we stay together, right? And we move forward to the kingdom of God." So he said, be strong and stay together. A few words about the readings. That first one, huh? What God has to say to us through Isaiah. "You say it's my ways that are not fair." Is it my ways that are not fair or your ways not fair? Which is, it's amazing how often we blame God for things he's not to blame for. We do. I was with, right before I got named a bishop, a gentleman came to me and he was struggling. He was really angry at God. He wasn't going to go to church anymore because his dad was dying from lung cancer. And I knew him well. We had a wonderful visit, prayed together. And at the end, because I knew him so well, I was able to have just challenge him a little. So you can be angry with God. He can handle it. Don't worry about that. But don't leave him. Then you're in trouble, right? You got to stay with him when you're angry. Just like in marriage, you're going to get angry at each other, but you got to stay together. It'll pass, hopefully. But it's amazing. I said to him, "He has lung cancer." He said, "Yeah." I said, "Was he a smoker?" He said, "Yeah, he smoked for 40 years. I said, "How much?" "About 2 packs a day." I said, "You don't think that has a little effect on his lung cancer? You're blaming God, but God gave him freedom, free will. That's how we're like God. He lets him freely choose if he wants to smoke cigarettes. But there's a consequence that you have to take." And that's the same with us, huh? When we say, "Why is my knee, why do I need knee surgery?" Well, he lets you go out for football when you're 17, right? And you got it all wrecked, and you thought nothing of it, and didn't take care of it. Well, now you got arthritis. Right? And then we can blame God when he says to us, "Is it my ways that are unfair or are yours? Are you taking consequence for some of your actions?" Which ties right into the gospel. Right? They always tie together, the first reading and the gospel. They inform each other. When he says to the chief priests and the elders, so they're supposed to be the smart ones. They're supposed to be the inside track. And he says, the prostitutes and tax collectors are going to get to the kingdom of heaven before you. Why? Because they're converting. They actually see that they need a savior, that their life is a mess. All of our lives are a mess in one way or another. Do we admit it and say to Jesus, "Jesus, it's not that I'm just good enough. I want to be completely attached to you. What still needs to be converted in me? Especially where I don't want to see it. Where I don't want to admit that I gossip a lot. Where I don't want to admit these sorts of things." I was out in Anaconda and St. Peter's Church. Have you ever been to Anaconda? There was an old church there that fixed up. So they thought I was coming out to close it. So a lady called all around and told everyone, "You've got to come to church. The bishop's coming, and if it's packed, he won't close us." Well, it was packed. And at the end of Mass, I said, So I heard the rumor was I was closing the church. I said, it's not a rumor. Then they got quiet. And I said, it's a lie. You're lying about your bishop. And that does harm. It does harm. Now that's just a little example. She came up to me afterwards, crying. And she said, Bishop, will you forgive me? I was the one who called. And I said, I forgive you. And I gave her a hug. And I said, but I have an assignment for you. It worked. So every Sunday, you get up and you call everyone you called this last week. And you say, you got to come to church. It might be our last one. Because all of us will have a last mass. Every one of us will have a last mass. I doubt that she will do it. But why wouldn't we? If we really believed that this could be our last mass. Right? Striving, looking. And I'm sure even if she'd call and say, come to mass again. Why, is the bishop coming to close it? Uh-uh. Well, why do I have to come? That's what starts to get into our habits, huh? That's why Jesus is saying tax collectors and prostitutes have a better chance than those of us, it scares me, who are smug, thinking, I'm all right, I'm done. I just got to stumble along here for a little bit and in I go. He says it in other places. Saying, Lord, Lord, isn't enough, right? It's got to change our innards, our inside out, right? Not just on the outside, but inside. And where is he calling me to that deeper conversion? He gives that just simple example of the one son who says, no, I'm not going. Then he changes his mind and does it. And the other one who has the right answer, but just doesn't do it, right? So to ask Jesus, help me to be more converted to you, especially in those areas where I'm stubborn, where I don't want to change, right? I have to have it my way in this. It's an encouragement to all of us not to just have it my way. I remember my dad when we were little kids, when we didn't get to do something we wanted, we'd say, how come I never get to do what I want? And he said, you better get used to it, because that's the rest of your life. And that's actually the gospel in a nutshell. Not just doing what I want, but dying to myself for others. Dying to my own self. Right? Doesn't mean being walked upon, but it means looking honestly and saying, what am I holding on to that it's my way? And I'm not willing to die to that. Finally, the second reading. It can seem like a throwaway line every time we hear it. It's been striking me this year more than any other time in my life. Paul does it the most. When he starts his letter, brothers and sisters, those aren't throwaway words. In fact, from the very beginning, when the first followers of Jesus were baptized, they began to call each other brothers and sisters. It's actually, you are my brothers and sisters more, in a more real way, than my own biological brothers and sisters. We're never alone. You have billions and billions and billions of brothers and sisters. Some in heaven, some in purgatory, some on earth. And yet we're walking around more and more lonely and isolated. And we're not helping each other, seeing one another as my brother and sister. Too much division in the church too, right? We just want to stay with like-minded people. It creeps everywhere. But we have to go to a more basic level. This is my brother, my sister, that I disagree with, that I don't see eye to eye with, that first and foremost, we see the dignity of each one of us, that we have great dignity and worth, and to strive that way. The Holy Father's starting the synod on synodality for the next 2 years. It begins this month. They're on retreat right now. And he's been begging us. He begged us over there as bishops to journey with each other, to start with first that we're brothers and sisters. And then when we have disagreements, we go back to that and say, remember, we're brothers and sisters. And we keep going back and watch how that changes conversations and moves the ball forward, right? That helps us. This is nothing new, right? Divisions in the church. Acts of the Apostles, Paul's always mad. Telling them, stop the gossiping, the division, the, you know, comparing and all these things. Starts a church, he tells Timothy, I'll be back in a couple of years. Let me know what's going on. I'll send you a few letters. Then he comes back and says, what the heck? You turned on the gospel already? You forgot already the gospel that Jesus Christ taught? Now you got something else? What the heck? Right? So it's nothing new. But they were called to conversion and they took it seriously. My brothers and sisters, let's take the call to conversion more seriously. For the sake of our marriages and families, for the sake of the church, for the sake of our society, huh? For the sake of our country, where the divisions, it's like, can't we talk about anything without it being a division? So I had our priests gathering in Butte for 4 days, and I talked to them for an hour and a half. I let them have it too a little bit, right? I said, driving around the diocese, I have to say that I've been here now 3.5 years. Some parishes and some priests identify more with a political party than with their faith. And that's sad, that this parish is this way and this one's this way, and it's more from a political vision than about the universality of the people of God. The church is big, but it's not to be with titles. Pope Francis told us, he asked some questions in one of his answers, he said, everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. Prostitute, prisoners, homosexuals, heterosexuals, political parties, and he went through this whole list, young, old, sick, healthy, fat, skinny, ugly, beautiful. He said, you're all welcome. Everyone is welcome. But leave your flags at the door. Leave your banners, your crusades, your political party. Leave it at the door. And be a family. More than identifying with these sorts of flags. That's a pretty dang good answer, isn't it? Because that's what happens. We can get tempted that we want to be on a crusade for this or that or other thing. Where the crusade we need to be on is to identify in our baptismal grace as brothers and sisters on a journey with Jesus in his church to heaven. And I think heaven's going to have quite a few different people in it. So we better get used to it, because it's going to be eternity of it. My brothers and sisters. I believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible.
I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Strengthened by the word of God, let us place before the Lord our prayers for the world.
We pray for the church on the eve of a new phase in the synodal journey. May the presence of the gospel be alive and at work in her. Make her like the vineyard in the parable, a vital place where all men and women who seek meaning in their life find a place, a word, and a breath of hope. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the bishops and all the participants in the synodal assembly. May proposals spring forth from their listening to the Holy Spirit, so that the entire people of God, in a dynamism of communion, may feel that they are truly participating in the life of the church and be a living and attractive witness to the newness of the gospel in the world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the peoples and nations of the world. May the human family prosper in the ways of peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for our country and all who call it home. May we be a people who seek justice for the oppressed and forgotten. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for an abiding respect for God's gift of human life. May we treasure the lives of all people, in particular those who live on the margins of society. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
During this time of harvest, we pray for those who receive nourishment from our Jubilee Garden. May they thrive both in body and spirit through the outpouring of love from those who work in the garden. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for us gathered here in communion with Christian communities throughout the world, that by tasting the goodness of the Lord that comes to each one in the body and blood of Jesus, we may receive from him a fresh view of our neighbor and be made witnesses to generosity in the world in which we live. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all who have died. In particular, Margail Prestipino, for whom our Mass is offered. May they rest in the peace of Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious God, you open the way to eternal life to your beloved creation. In you rests all our hope. Receive our prayers, that we may grow in openness and fidelity each day. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant us, O merciful God, that this our offering may find acceptance with you, and that through it the wellspring of all blessing may be laid open before us through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It's truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. As we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you've held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who've died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Peace with you. Thanks for having me. Peace with you, son. Peace with you.
God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
welcome our viewers on live stream this evening. We pray for you, and please pray for us, and all of us grow in holiness and love the Lord all the days of our lives. We give the Lord glory and praise together in heaven someday soon. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. May this heavenly mystery, O Lord, restore us in mind and body, that we may be co-heirs in glory with Christ, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Please join us for the dinner this evening in the social center with the bishop right after Mass. Join us for the blessing of the animals tomorrow, October 1st at 1 p.m. in the social center parking lot. All animals and people are welcome. Our basket auction will begin on October 7th at 4 p.m. Please see the bulletin for details. We need to collect non-perishable food items for Thanksgiving food boxes. Food slips are now available in the gathering space.
So, if you're able to come over, it'd be great. I'll answer some of your questions and tell you what I've been up to and about our capital campaign that's right around the corner. We're in the pilot phases right now. St. Mary's will take part in January. So it'll be a good time for you to hear it from me, right? From my mouth. And then you don't have to listen to rumors. It's a lot easier. Right? If you just hear it from the person that's actually doing it. So if you can, if you have questions, now's your time. You don't get to ask bishops questions that often. So if you are wondering something, please come down. Thank you for feeding me too. So that's nice of you. It's good to be with you. Good to be with you here. I know I've been here three or four times, I think. So it's nice to be with you as well. During this month of October, I encourage you as you do your daily prayers to pray for the Synod. Our Holy Father sent all the bishops the prayer we're going to do right now, and intercessions that he wrote for this month, so that we're with them in prayer as they gather to see how we can better journey with all the people of God and all humanity throughout the world. So the Lord be with you. Brothers and sisters, Jesus promised to be present in the midst of his disciples gathered in his name. In the coming days at Rome, Pope Francis will open the first session of the 16th Ordinary General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops. Invoking the blessing of the Lord, we lift our minds to God, that by the stirring of the Holy Spirit, he may strengthen our communion, lead us to all truth, and enlighten the participants of the Synodal Assembly without ceasing. The Lord be with you.
Bow down to the blessing.
May our God and Father, who in many and various ways spoke to our fathers through the prophets, direct you and the whole church in fidelity to his word and in discernment of his will. Amen. May the only begotten Son, sent in the fullness of time to manifest to all the riches of the Father's mercy, keep you in communion with himself and your brothers and sisters. Amen. May the Holy Spirit lead you all, and especially the assembly, the Synodal Assembly, to perceive the signs of the times, so that adhering to the will of God in all things, you may bear the abundant fruit of unity by promoting the life of the church and witnessing to the gospel. Amen. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.